think it's time to start the next presentation. My name is Holger. I work as a data scientist slash data engineer at a big German federal research center. And I'm also very interested in evaluating how we can bring the power of Kotlin to the more data-centric world. Because at the moment, they somehow are more distinct, so there's not so much intersection between the two. And today, we will really try to establish a data science workflow with pure Kotlin. And as an example, I will take you on a wild ride through New York City. That's at least the plan. So let's see how this goes. So how does a data science life cycle look like? So there's a typical set of tasks you have to implement in order to analyze data. And it always starts with the data ingestion step. So you import your data, you clean it up in some way. And then there's often an iterative process where you transform your data, you visualize your data, you build some predictive modeling solution. And you often repeat this process a couple of times, and at the very end, when you're happy with your model, you then communicate your results, you deploy it as a service, depending on your needs. If you're using Python, there's a well-established stack. So you have Pandas, you have Matplotlib, there's Seaborn, there's quite a few packages you can use to work on such solutions. Also with R, they have a very elaborate and evolved stack, including packages like Redar, TidyR, dplyr, and ggplot, which you can use to implement such data science solutions. However, on the JVM, and in particular on Kotlin, it's not so clear, at least it was not so clear to me, how we would approach such a problem. So can we do data science with Kotlin? In order to answer this, let's break up the question a bit. So we need a couple of things in order to implement a data science workflow. First is we need some kind of interactive computing environment. So it's not like classical software engineering where we write down a program, we write a couple of unit tests, but it's more an interactive process. So the question is there something which we could use here? Second one is, can we manipulate typed and untyped data? So I will detail out later what we mean by that. For sure, we also need to visualize our data. So in order to get an idea about patterns and artifacts in our data, we want to make certain visualizations. And finally, we want to communicate our findings. And for this, we need to either build some report or use some kind of notebook solution. I mean, let's see what's on offer here with respect to the JVM and Kotlin. Can we do this? We won't know without trying. So what I would like to do today with you is to predict New York taxi trip durations with Kotlin. So this is not a problem I have made up, but it's coming from a big platform called Kaggle.com. Let's go there. So it's a data science competition platform. So if you go to Kaggle, they have tons of competitions where somebody is posting a problem, which means a data set. And the question is always to build some kind of predictive modeling solution, where you then, which you then use to predict some target attribute on a test set. Your solution is then submitted back into the system. And then for each of the competitions, they have leaderboards. And typically, after a while, the best performing model gets some prize money associated to the competition. There's one competition which I've picked for this tutorial, for this introduction. It's the New York City Taxi Trip Duration Challenge. The idea is very simple. That's also why I picked it. We have a data set, let's check here, which is about taxi drives, taxi rides in New York City. So we know a couple of things about each trip. We need the, we know the pickup time. We need how many passengers were involved. We know where they were picked up. We know where they want to go, which is a drop-off. And we have some other properties which are not yet so clear why we might need them. But for sure, it's all very interesting what we have here, because every attribute might be predictive for the trip duration. So that's really the target attribute. There's two data sets. There's a training part, where we know the trip duration. So this we can use to build our model. And then there's a test set for which we don't know the trip duration, for which we need to use our predictive model in order to come up with some best guess about how long a trip might take. So what we do in order to get started is we click this download all button over here, which I won't click now because of the slow network. So I've done this already. And what we get is just a zip file, which I put here on my desktop. So let's simply unzip it. And we get a folder. Let's go in here. So there's three files. It's zip files again. So let's uncompress them all. And as we see, we just got a couple of CSV files. So let's go to the terminal now and CD into this directory. And let's simply head just to get started the data. So this looks like a rather complex table. So let's also head the sample submission. This looks a bit more easy to grasp. So this is basically what they assume us to submit at the very end. So there's some idea of a taxi trip, and we are supposed to predict the duration. So this is for sure just an example, and we need to come up with a similar table for the test data they provide. All right, so we have some data, we have a problem, but how would we approach such a problem by using Kotlin? I mean, that's the question here. So let's jump back to the slides. So let's start with the first part, the interactive shell. There is a REPL in IntelliJ, so it's bundled with the platform. But it's an ongoing process, and I know the people are really working hard to make it better. But at the moment, there's a couple of issues which make it, for me at least, not possible to work with the built-in REPL in order to establish such a data flow. Luckily, there's a project on GitHub, which is called Sparklin. And Sparklin is a proof of concept software so far, which comes along with a new, more experimental REPL. And I looked at it, and it worked for me much better than the bundled REPL, which comes with the IDE. The only problem at the moment is it's not shipping with a more evolved launcher, I would say. So what we need to do in order to spin up a shell for a given data science project is we have some script where we declare dependencies, as we can do now with Kotlin 1.3, but which we could also do with third-party tools like Kscript in the past. And then we simply use this script as an argument for some shell launcher. So let's see whether we can do this for our little project here. So I've already created some draft, and as you can see here on the side, maybe not so well, there's a few blue ticks here where we want to interactively evolve this workflow. But for sure, writing down the whole workflow would be a bit too much given the time constraints we have here. So let's get the path of this script. So it's sitting here. It's just a Kotlin script, so there's really just a single file here, not a huge hierarchy of objects and classes. And then we want to spin up a shell. So we say we want a K shell from a KTS file. We provide the reference to our script. And then it takes a second, because now internally the K shell, so the Sparklin framework, will resolve all the dependencies. And now we have a prompt. So it's really working like a Python prompt, like an R prompt. We can do basic math here, so we could say what's 1 plus 1. The first one, it takes a while, but then it's also getting a bit faster if you try it again. Okay, so we mastered the first step. We have some interactive compute environment. How can we now deal with the data? So that's a more tricky problem, because we still have these massive tables. We have now shell, but how can we bring this data into our interactive environment here? Let's go back to our presentation. So, and let's talk a bit about how to manipulate typed and untyped data. So first, for sure, there's the Kotlin standard library. I mean, I think that's always a good starting point, because it's an excellent library. There's tons of stuff which works really great. So there's useful I/O utilities. We have all these functions to map, to fold, to filter, to reduce collections. And it's really fun to use it. There's also a grouping API, because grouping is a very important concept when it comes to dealing with data. But in my opinion, and I will detail out in a second, it's not sufficient to really implement the data science lifecycle as we've seen it on the first slide. I've checked out what's in the internet, and there's quite a few libraries. And I mean, many of them were really a great source of inspiration for myself. But in the end, none of them really was feature complete enough, or maintained enough, or Kotlin-esque enough to make working with data using Kotlin real fun. That's why I thought, OK, let's just to see how far we can get, let's create a new project. So I set up a project called Krangle, which is a shortcut for Kotlin DSL for data wrangling. And it's a library which implements a grammar for data manipulation using a modern functional style API. So what's the data model of Krangle? It uses, I mean, we implement a very naive approach here, I would say. So we simply say we have a data frame, so a table. And a table is simply a list of columns. So I think that's the most naive approach path you can go if you want to implement a table model. And then each column by itself has a name and an array of values. So we don't do any optimization or column compression here. We just try to stay very simple and to see whether we can implement an API around using Kotlin, which makes it more fun to work with data compared to R or Python. So how would we get our data into the system? First, for sure, we could simply write some builder API to define the data in place. So we could have a couple of column names and simply write down the data within the application. That's one way, and I think it's also a useful way. But for sure, we can easily imagine that we might want to read and write from JSON, TSV, CSV, database, and so on. And all this has been implemented for Kringle. And it's trying its best to guess column types and has a to have sensible default parameters. So let's try to get our taxi data into our interactive compute environment. So let's go here. This we don't need anymore. So at the beginning, we need to tell the system where the data is. So what we can do, we can push using a shortcut. It's a plugin for the IntelliJ platform. We can push our current expression or our current line into our compute environment. And that's what I'm going to use all the time now. So the first thing is we do, we list the files in the directory and check what's there. And no surprise here, obviously, because we just see the files we've seen in Finder already. All right, the next thing we do, and I think we are already doing some engineering here, we want to read in a file, like one of the CSV files, but yeah, we are a bit lazy, and we also like the more shell-like way of referring to file names, so we create an own custom operator to resolve a file name, and then we can use this operator to point our Kringle library to the a big training data set, and it's in fact a big data set, it's 1.4 million records, I think. So it takes a second in order to load it. And once we have loaded it, I mean, we could just analyze it as it is, but for sake of doing some exploratory data analysis, we can also subsample a bit. And this is what we are going to do. So we just get some proportion, in this case 30% of the data, as a training example. So let's do some interactive coding now. So the first thing we would like to do for sure is we want to explore the structure of our table. So let's just write down the name of it and evaluate this in the shell. And as we see here, we get some kind of nice high-level overview of the first couple of records. We see some of the first columns, but it's a complex data set. So at the very end, it tells us that there's quite a few more rows and there's also more variables, so we cannot fit it on a screen, which just makes sense. So we can also peek into the data from a more vertical dimension. So we can say we would like to see the schema of it. And now we see something which doesn't look so convincing. It looks a bit messed up. And that's because we just have limited space in the terminal here. So what we can do, we can reconfigure the width of our terminal environment. And then we can try the same again. And this did not work out. Let's try. So maybe it's still too much, so let's reduce it a bit further. And now it looks sensible. Now we have a pretty nice idea about what the taxi data is all about. So we really see the different attributes. OK, there's a vendor ID. It might be predictive. Obviously, the ID won't be predictive for the duration of the trips. But then there's these other attributes, which I think are really interesting. So the pickup coordinates, the drop-off coordinates, and a few more. And for sure, since we're talking about the training data here, we have the trip duration. So we know already what we're looking for. Later on, in the test data, we might not see that. But what's a bit strange here is that we have the drop-off longitude as well. So, and if we know, and also the drop-off daytime. And for sure, if we have both the pickup and the drop-off time, we could easily calculate the trip duration. So let's test whether in the test data we see the same structure. So we do the same here. So we say we would like to load a data frame from a CSV file. And again, we say we have our data root. And in under this data root, we have the file called train CSV. We load it. It takes a second to load. And then we use the same approach as before. We peek vertically and horizontally into the data. So let's see how this goes. All right, so we this is a structure, so it's showing us again just a few of the attributes, and there's also quite a few additional. I loaded this wrong one, so it's obviously the test one we want to explore here. So let's do the test thing, and then we peek into the data. And again, we cannot fit the data onto the screen, so I think in this case, again, it's more helpful to explore the schema of our data. And here we see that some of the attributes are now missing, so there's no drop-off time anymore, so we cannot cheat by simply doing the diff of drop-off time and pickoff time, and there's also no trip duration. So we really have to come up with some more sophisticated model now to guess the trip duration, because that's what they, that's the data set they want us to process. That's a challenge. All right, so we explored the data, and now for sure we want to dig into the individual attributes. How can we do that? So because we are using Kotlin, we can use get, and that's what the library provides to access individual columns, but also not just by index, but also by name. And by convention, instead of saying .get, we can also use square brackets to, for instance, access the first column in our data set. And as we see in our KShell environment, the first column is the vendor ID. We see the type, the length, and the first couple of example records here. And we can do the same with the name. So we could say trip duration, because that's what we're interested in. Oh, trip duration is not here, so let's say vendor ID. But you already see what's happening. I struggle a bit with the typing. So this time I was lucky, I got it right. But what we can for sure now, and I think this is what we should do, is we should try to get rid of these strings, because we would have to retype them again and again. And to make the whole thing a bit more robust, I think a good approach is to simply take the data description from the project website in this case and paste it in here. And then we can simply evaluate all those guys. This is simply copied from the Kaggle website. So. Because what we can do now, we can simply say, this is our data, and we would like to access the trip duration. And now we get completion. So I think this is really something nice, which you would not get in Python, for instance, because here the IDE helps us. I mean, it's not a typed approach we are using, so we haven't defined any type. It's still untyped data, but we are leveraging the IDE power to make our life a bit more simple. So we can do this, and then we have the same result. All right, let's jump back to the slides for a second. So we managed to get our data into the computer environment, and now we for sure need to do something with it. And the question is, what do we need? I mean, what do we expect from a library so that we can conveniently process tables with it? There's tons of designs, tons of different libraries. I mean, I've worked a lot with the so-called Tidyverse, which is an R environment, or it's a set of R packages, which are designed to deal with data in a very efficient and, I would say, elegant way. So they have stuff for data structures. They have a module called TidyR for preparation. They have some processing elements. And then they have this dplyr package, where they basically argue that most of the data processing tasks when it comes to table processing can be handled by just 5 + 1 functions. And those functions are listed over here. So there you want to select columns, you want to inspect subsets of data, you want to add new ones, you want to reorder rows, you want to summarize records, and then there's the +1, which is the grouping. So the grouping by itself doesn't do a thing. It just adds some inherent grouping to the data so that the functions from above would be performed in a group way. So you would do a per group summary, for instance. So I thought, OK, this sounds very reasonable, and I've also used this a lot. So I then went ahead and took all the cheat sheets from the Tidyverse, at least the relevant ones, and re-implemented the corresponding functions for the Kranger library. So we have functions for summarizing cases, grouping, manipulation of variables. But there's also more stuff when it comes to table joining, summary functions, and also about data nesting. So there's quite a few things implemented in Kranger already. And I think because of the time constraints we have, I just would like to give you one example here, and then we can go to the New York City trip data and work with it. So this is basically how the flow looks like when working with Kranger. So we start with some data. In this case, it's flight data. And then we could group it via one or multiple attributes. And we could select attributes of interest. You could summarize then per group. We could filter the data. And at the very end, sort it to, according to some attribute which we've created or which was already in the data, and then we can print the data to get an idea about patterns and structure in our input data. One very important aspect when it comes to dealing with data, especially in a JVM environment, is should we use typed data or should we use more generic untyped structures? And for sure, I love types. I mean, that's why I also like Kotlin. I like static types, but very often data has no type, and it's very tedious to define a type. Just to give you an example with an employee, so let's assume you have a couple of employees, and we want to do stuff with them. So we could imagine that we want to predict sick days, add performance metrics, add salaries, and so on and so on. What we would need to do here is, because the employee has no such thing, I mean, he has an ID and a name, but there's no way to attach additional information about the number of sick days to it. So what we would need to do is to define a new type after every computation, which makes it very hard and very tedious. In R, in contrast, people keep it simple. They have more generic tables, they simply add another column. So there's no such concept type data, which makes the life more easy, but for sure you also lose a bit of structure. So what I thought, the perfect mix would be to have both. To have on the one hand side more basic columns like the age and the address, but then also allow for object columns. Like you say you have a column where you store your employees. Or even going one step further, you could even have a list of something in a cell within such a table. And for sure, going along with this, you would need an API which allows you to, for instance, join on the employee column or use some generics to easily manipulate cell values. And that's what Krangle is implementing. So it comes along with various tools to streamline this process. The first thing is it can ingest any type of iterable, which I think is a very useful feature. So whenever you have something like a list of something, you can always say as data frame, which will internally use reflection to destructure the data and give you a table. So here's an example. So we define a data class, we create a list of persons, and then we simply say as data frame. And when we print this, we see we have two columns in our table, one with the age, one with the name, which I think makes it very easy to bring your existing data into such a structure where you can modify it more easily. You can also go the more manual approach. If you say, this is too much or won't work for my too complex type, you can also deparse or destructure your records manually using such an approach. To give you one example, before we go back to the New York City data, we would like to fit regression models, linear regression models. And as an example here, we use flower properties. So there's this famous iris data set. The first thing we do is to group our data by species. So we don't want to model the complete table in one go, but we rather would like to create dedicated models for each of the species. Once we have attached the grouping to our table, we can then summarize our data. So we create a new column called LM. And within this summarize function, we can use a lambda element here, where we extract the predictor and the response variable. And then we use a third-party library, in this case it's Apache Commons Math, to build a simple regression model, which we then simply add as one of the columns of our data set. I mean, it looks a bit odd here in the schema, because obviously the Apache Commons people haven't really thought about creating a nice toString method for their type. But I think you really see the point here that we can now have an object column. And in the last step, we can then use some generic approach to extract aspects of this object column and put them into further columns. So this is just an example to give you an idea about how Krangle tries to combine object-oriented programming with this more generic type of data processing. So let's go back to our New York data example. So the first thing, I mean, let's ignore this function context here for a second. I will talk about it in a brief minute. So the first thing we need to do if we look at our data, we just have these date times here, but they are just strings. So the first thing we need to do is we need to pass them into a proper date object so that we can manipulate it. And for this, we just use regular JDK classes. So let's do this. We define a date pattern, and then we can extract the column with the dates and really look into the values and simply extract one of them. Just to make sure that our pattern is working correctly. And if we try to run it, it says it's not possible. What does it say? Text could not be passed. OK, that's not good. Let's check. All right. That's a bit strange. OK. OK, this worked. I'm a bit surprised now. So we could pass the data. So what we do is we say we would like to add another column, and then we have some special way of detailing out the column specification. So again, here we use predefined attribute names to enable completion, and then we use a lambda where we extract the existing pickup data, which is just a basic string, and then we say we would like to map those strings by parsing them into a date object. And after this processing step, if we look into our data again, we see that the data is now indeed a local date time object. So we successfully transformed it from a string into a regular object. The next thing we need to do in order to build a predictive model is to calculate the distance between the pickup and the drop-off position. And you can look this up online how you would do so. There's a Stack Overflow solution. So what we need to do here is we need to define a function which takes the longitude and latitude coordinates and does some fancy math here in order to calculate the distance. Once we have this function, we again do the same, if we follow the same pattern here, we say we would like to add another column to our data set, which we call a distance, and then we use this coord distance function to calculate the distances for each trip. All right, and the last thing we do is now since we have passed our pickup datetime, we can also extract various properties, which might be predictive for our target attribute, which is trip duration. As you can imagine, for instance, the months could be predictive because in winter when it's more snowy, trips might be slower, in summer it might be faster, but for sure also the hour of the day is very important. Like in the morning or during rush hour, trips are also likely to take a bit longer. So we would like to extract those columns as well. So let's peek into our data again. Now it looks a bit more complex. So we've added a couple of columns for the month, the day of the week, and the hour, and also whether it's a work day or not. And the reason why I wrapped the whole block here into function is that we would like to reuse this feature engineering workflow, which we've just established, also for our test data later. So let's use this, put it into our environment, and then we can reuse the same procedure later to process the test data as well. All right, so now we process data. Next step for sure is we still haven't got a good idea about underlying patterns. So what we would like to talk about now is data visualization, which I think is really crucial when it comes to dealing with data. And there's, again, existing options, and there are really great projects here. But for me, they weren't, again, not really complete or convenient, probably also because I'm biased. I use a lot of R. I know my stuff, I'm getting older, so you know, old men stick to your horses. So I thought, yeah, maybe I could just reuse what I already know. That's why I then went ahead and thought, okay, yeah, the best for me would be if you would just do the same as in R. And in R, there's an excellent, it's really a lovely package for data visualization. It's called ggplot. And conceptually, what they do, I mean, it was also written down in a book from Leland Wilkinson in 2005, is you can formalize every plot as a mapping of data attributes to visual attributes. That's what they call aesthetics. Then you need a couple of layers which detail out what type of visualization, what kind of geometries you would like to show. You need a coordinate system, optional transformations, and potentially you may want to split up your plot into a grid, like if you want to facet your plot. And with this approach, they argue, and this is actually the case, you can create a wide range of plots. This made it sounded really great for me, and I thought, oh, it would be so cool if you could do the same thing in Kotlin, because that's one of the weaknesses when it comes to data science on the JVM. Visualization is still very tricky. So let's see how far we can get here. Again, I set up a small experimental GitHub repo called Crevice, which is another shortcut for Kotlin grammar for data visualization. So I couldn't really decide whether I should take the G or the K for the Crevice. Anyway. And what it does is it implements a DSL, or call it grammar, depending on your preferences, to create a wide range of plots using a standardized set of verbs. And internally, it's doing something super lazy. It's just calling R. So what so that's basically the design. We start writing some Kotlin code. That's Kotlin code here. Internally, it's transcompiled into R, and then we can use a variety of different backends to actually do the rendering. So we could use a local Dockerized R installation. I mean, that's basically what's shipping with the tool. But we could also just use a local R. I mean, if you don't want Docker or don't like Docker, we could also use a remote R in case we don't want anything local on my computer, but we have some server or centralized infrastructure. We could potentially also think about doing a native binding, which is not in place yet. And so after we've transcompiled our code, we will evaluate it, and then we will generate whatever output format is desired by the user. And then what's also part of the library is a couple of output devices. And we really try to standardize things a bit here, that the same approach works, not just locally using a Swing or JavaFX device, but that we could also simply dump it into a file or even use it in Jupyter notebooks, as we will see later. So let's have a look at two examples. First one is using regular Kringle tables. So we just have a table structure as we've looked at already. And the idea is that we take some data, in case this is a mammalian sleep data set, also a very famous data set in the community. We add some new column using Kringle. And then we simply say we would like to plot this object. And we do what I've just explained before. We map data attributes shown over here to visual attributes. That's basically the only hard work which we have to do here. We have to think about this mapping, and for sure, and afterwards, you also have to decide about geometry, which we would like to use here. And once we are done with the specification, we can simply evaluate it and get this lovely output, given just this very rather short snippet of code. To give you another example using the type API, because you might say, this table stuff is nice, but I prefer object-oriented programming. I have an iterable, I have a collection of things, of objects. How can I use Travis with this iterable? And it makes it very easy for you as well here. So one approach is you could simply map your data attributes via property references to data attributes. So that's one approach. It also provides a few other modes. And then the downstream process is exactly the same. So you then think about the layers, and then you can customize your plot as needed. All right, to give you a more integrated example, using another data science library, which Thomas already mentioned before, as a SMILE library, we would like to perform a PCA analysis. A PCA is a dimensional reduction technique. So if you have a high dimensional data set, you often want to break down dimensionality so that you can visualize it, that you see about, you can check clusterings and stuff. And SMILE implements such a method. So all we have to do is we have to map the Kringle data structures to something SMILE understands, and it's simply an array of numbers it wants as input. And then once we have processed the data by performing the PCA, we can then pull out the results. And in this case, we use something which is similar to the property references, but here we destruct as a result, as a PCA, directly when specifying the mapping of data attributes to the visual attributes. So there's no intermediate step anymore. And with this small bit up here, we get estimates about how much variance is explained by each principal component in the PCA. And down here, we see the actual dimensionality reduction. So we take the PCA, we project our data to a two-dimensional space, and then we can simply use Kotlin standard library, like we zip it with the species labels, and then we map the data to the first and to the second component, so the X and the Y, and the color we map them to the species, and we simply say this is a point geometry we are interested in, and then we get this lovely plot, which is not complicated, and I think it's really one-to-one what I would do in R, and I really like the way it works in R, and I think many people agree that the way the ggplot framework on the grammar around this is designed is really, so far, people haven't come up with better designs, I would say. OK, let's go back to New York City. Let me quickly look at the time. OK. So I've cheated. So I have some kind of Git diff here. So all right, let's do one plot together. The first thing we might be interested in is, since we have this test data, let's look at it again. So we have these various attributes, and some of them might be predictive for the trip duration. And one easy one to start with, because it's also very intuitive, is the number of passengers in each cab. So let's simply say we would like to plot this table. And as we've discussed, the only thing we have to think about is which data attributes do we want to map to what visual attribute. And in this case, we simply map the passenger count to the X And what we would like to do is some kind of bar chart where we count the number of passenger counts, so like some kind of cross tabulation. And if you do this, we see some window popping up. I hope at least that we see this window popping up. Exactly, and here we are. So now we have to rearrange windows a bit, so there's not so much space, but I think we can make it work. All right, it doesn't look so convincing yet, because let's resize it a bit, because as you will see, the x-axis does not really look convincing, because it thinks that passenger count is some kind of more continuous attribute, but obviously it's a discrete variable. And we can instruct the Kravis API that this is a discrete variable by simply saying this is a discrete variable. So let's do the same plot again. And now I think it should look a bit better, because yes, now we on the X we get a more categorical description of how many passengers are in each cab. And what we see here is that in most cabs there's just a single person, but there must be some big vehicles out there as well, because in some of them there's up to 6 passengers. So let's speed up the process a bit. So we can also look at other attributes, so like, for instance, the trip duration, I mean, it's really central to the whole challenge here, is something which we are definitely interested in. And if we look at the distribution of the trip duration, I mean, we have to trim the distribution here a bit. As you can see here, we filter our data set first for trip durations which are less than 1,000 seconds, just to get a better idea, because there are some outliers in the data. And then we get a good feeling already about the median and the mean duration of each trip, which is around 300 seconds. So on average, people just use a cab for just 5 minutes. For sure, the question is, are we really looking at New York City here? Because this is pretty generic, we don't know. So what we can do, we can visualize the pickup longitude and pickup latitude coordinates. And if this is really New York City data, it should look like New York City in some way. So let's have a look. Again, all we do is we map the data attributes to visual attributes, to the X and to the Y. And it takes quite a while, because we have hundreds of thousands of data points in our data set, so all of them need to be rendered. But here it is, and it does not look like New York City, obviously. I mean, there's some kind of point cloud up here, but yeah, the reason is simple. Sometimes people take long trips, so they start in New York City and go somewhere, to Oregon or to Washington, D.C., I have no idea. And for sure, these artifactual or these outlier data points, they really hide the true pattern. So what we can easily do is we can constrain the coordinates, and that's what we're going to do. We could simply say we just zoom into a certain window of longitude and latitude coordinates, and then we, because this is defined as an extension function on data frame, we can simply throw it into our workflow here. We keep the rest as it is, and let's do the same thing again. Let's wait how it looks like. And I think we should look more familiar, more like New York City. So, where is it? All right. So this looks already much more promising. So we see something which resembles Manhattan with some fantasy. We also see the airport, JFK. And so it's really New York we're looking at. So I think this is something very good. So we are seeing the correct structure here. What's a bit hard to see, because we overplot a lot, is where we have, I mean, hotspots. So where do people use cabs the most? So what we can do here is we can keep the aesthetics mapping. So we still map pickup and longitude and latitude to the X and the Y, but we throw in a different visualization, like a 2D binning. And the 2D binning will basically split up the whole plot into small grid elements, count the number of taxi rides, and then, as you can see here, I hope you see it, we see some kind of hotspot of taxi rides right in the heart of Manhattan, which I think is something, this is a type of visualization which is better than the simple scatter plot, because here we can really see some kind of density profile across the city. All right. What we could also do is to correlate the distance of the trip with the trip duration to see whether there's some kind of correlation, because that's what we're mainly interested in. We want to know which attributes in our data are predictive for our target attribute. And again, here we don't see much, so we could use the same trick. We could say We would like to use a density binning to see whether there's a potential correlation between these two attributes. And again, actually there is. I mean, we have to use logarithmic scales here, but you can see that there's some kind of dependency between both attributes. So it will be good to include distance in order to predict duration. So there's other aspects which we could try, but unfortunately, because of lack of time, I think I have to skip some of the examples. You can look them up later in the GitHub repo if you want to. So let's quickly jump back to the slides. So we are able to visualize our data, and for sure the last part is about bringing it all together and then submitting it to Kaggle, showing it to a colleague. How would we do that? I mean, for sure, first we have to build the actual model. So let's go back to the IDE for a second, and we skip those plots. So what we would not What we will need to do here is we need to split up our data into a training and a test data set, which we in order to not overfit our classifier. Then we can prepare our data. And later on, we can then, oh, wait a second. OK, so now it failed. There's some issue with one of the dates, all right? And basically, what we would like to do then is to select the predictor of interest, build a training matrix, and then we could use a library, for instance, like XGBoost, which is pretty popular in the community, to build an actual classifier. And once we have this classifier, in this case, we have to configure XGBoost to build us a regression model, because that's what we would like to do. We would like to regress and calculate the, or predict the trip duration. And at the very end, once we are happy with the performance of our model on the validation data set, for sure we would then apply the same procedure to our test data of interest. And at the very end, then write out a Kaggle submission file where we then combine the trip duration predicted by our model with the existing IDs in the test data. We can write out a CSV file, and then we can submit this to Kaggle. For sure, with the kernel we've just built, we won't win the Kaggle competition. But this was also not the main idea of the talk. The idea was more to give an idea about a potential technology stack which you could use to analyze your own data using just Kotlin. So let's jump back to the slides for the summary. So the last part, which we haven't talked about in detail yet, is report rendering and notebook support. Many of you may have heard about Jupyter. Jupyter is an open source web application which allows to create notebooks. And luckily, there's also support for Kotlin. So there's two competing kernel implementations. One is called Kotlin Jupyter. The other one is called DKX. I have mainly worked with the first one, the Kotlin Jupyter kernel yet. And what it basically allows is that you have, within the browser, the ability to create code cells. You can also load in dependencies. And then you would work interactively within the browser to analyze your data. For sure, what you lose here is all the IDE tooling. So that's why I'm always more in favor of doing a more literate programming approach, where you start just with a script and then use some tool chain to render a report, for instance. In Python, you can do this with Notedown and bqwrt. In R, there's also a stack here which basically involves Knitter and Pandoc. But the question is for sure, can we do this with Kotlin? Can we take a script and build an HTML report? Because I think this would be really something convincing, because then we could write down our analytics solution, compile it into an HTML report, and simply ship it to a customer. Yes, we can, but it's very hacky at the moment, I have to say. So basically, what we need to do is we can use R to convert our Kotlin script into a Markdown file. Then we need to mess around a bit with the Markdown file to fix some formatting issues. Then we can use Notedown, create a Jupyter notebook from the Markdown. And then we can use Jupyter and bqwrt with one of the Kotlin kernels, which we define as execute preprocessor. And then we can basically write it into an HTML file. So it's just a proof of concept, obviously, but let's jump to an example report here, which I've built before the presentation. So that's basically what we would get. So, where is it? Exactly. So that's our script, the script we were just writing. It converted it into Markdown and then into Jupyter Notebook and then was rendered into HTML. So we see exactly the same as we saw before, but now all condensed together. So we can peek into the directory structure, then we can look into the data, and then we learn that we might need to tweak the width of our terminal to make it more readable, and this works here in here as well. Then we can load our test data. Then we do this trick to get good completion in the IDE by defining the attribute names in our analysis. We do the feature engineering where we pass the dates, where we calculate distance, where we wrap the whole thing into a function which we can also apply to our test data. Then we go for data visualization using the Crevice wrapper library around ggplot. So we have inlined all the plots now here. They're a bit big, so that's still something to be optimized, obviously. But in general, I think it's a really good result because it really brings it together. This looks even better here because here we can even see this the street structure of Manhattan, and we see nicely the Central Park. So I think it's really, I mean, given that we started from a plain Kotlin script, I think it's really a nice end result. And I hope I could convince you that it's not really tied to the New York City data, but it's more a generic framework, a generic tool stack, which you could essentially apply to any type of data. And yeah, then we have the density plots. We assess potential correlation patterns using density again. Then we could also look at the speed. We have skipped this part in this case. So for instance, you could see that there's a tendency to have faster writes on the weekend, which is for sure something you would expect, but it's good to see it confirmed in the data. We can also look at the speed versus the hour. So we see that during the night, taxi rides are faster, which also makes sense because there's less traffic. And at the very end, we then build a predictive model. So we had to skip this part because of the time constraints, which we then can investigate here, so we can simply print it, but it's not so informative. So the XJBoost people, they didn't think about the two-string method, but we can use it to predict first on the validation set, but later on also on the test data. And at the very end, for sure, we want to know whether the model which we've built is really good and whether we can win the Kaggle competition with our model. So what we can do is we can correlate the trip duration in our validation data set with the predicted trip duration, and we see something which is a bit sad. Our model is not good. It's not good at all. Because obviously we had to, skip over so many steps you typically would do in such a data science project. We also didn't bring in external data, which is something people always do when dealing with Kaggle. But it was more a technology exploration here. It was not really about building the best kernel. But nevertheless, we can prepare a submission file. And I did so, and I submitted it to Kaggle. And it was not the worst model, so it was still in the top 90%. Yes. Unfortunately, I could not upload this nice Jupyter notebook to Kaggle yet because they just support Python and R at the moment. So even if we have a Jupyter notebook, a rendered Jupyter notebook, we cannot really make it public and tell the world about it. For sure, we have a GitHub repo where we can show it to people, but I think there's still a lot of room for improvement here. So let's... now it's really the end. So let's... So we did this one, yes. What's the future? So for sure, I mean, both Kraggle and Crevice are more API experiments. So my interest was really to learn about Kotlin, to get an idea about how far you can push it towards to becoming a R or Python-like data environment. And I think we made it quite far. For sure, there's quite a few things which need to be improved. So the overall stability, we need to improve the API coverage, so not all elements of ggplot are mapped to Crevice yet. Also on the data front, I mean, for sure, performance is a big issue. As I discussed in the beginning, we use a rather naive approach at the moment. No column compression, nothing. That's for sure something you may want to consider in order to make it a bit more production ready. And for sure we would, but I think that's the easy part. We would need to provide more bindings and examples which show how to use this library with other data science library running on the JVM. On the tooling side, I think there's also some work to do. So it's all a bit shaky at the moment, I would say. That's why it wasn't also not running so smoothly here. So on the Jupyter side, there's a couple of issues which make it really hard to establish such a workflow with Kotlin. So there would be, I think what would be really nice is to have support for custom type handlers, allow for multiple cell outputs. On the IDE side, I mean, what would be really helpful is to allow for debugging of Kotlin scripts, which is not yet possible. And also on the shell, which is really evolving quickly. But I think there's also some issues to be discussed and addressed sooner or later. So let's sum it up. I think we can build predictive models using Kotlin, so we could really establish a full data flow starting from the raw data, feature engineering, predictive model building, and reporting by just using existing tooling here. My humble contributions to the process are two API experiments. One is Krangle, which allows for data wrangling. The other is Crevice, which implements a DSL for data visualization. Tooling and libraries are improving, and yeah, I would like to thank the Kotlin and the IDE team a lot, the GitHub community, the R and Tidyverse people, and also my affiliations, so the Max Planck Institute for Molecular Cell Biology and Genomics. You can find the slides and the sources on GitHub, and yeah, for sure, if you have any questions or if you would like to talk about data science with Kotlin and with R and whatever, I would be really happy to talk to you. Thank you.